APCH 341 students. Professor Jeff Yarger here. I want to quickly go through another homework problem that's been given out of James Allen Biophysical Chemistry book out of chapter 2, and it's problem number 14. And I've basically copy and pasted directly the problem out of the back end of the chapter. And down here at the bottom, I've included the solution that's given at the back of the book for this, where they've given a work solution. And what I want to do here in this screencast is just go through this maybe in a little more detail to really bring this back and relate it to what I think of as the fundamental thermodynamics, and hopefully provide maybe some fundamental insight so that we're not just working problems, but we're working problems with a goal of trying to better understand thermodynamics and better get an intuition for using it for other similar types of problems. Okay, so let's delve in and look at this one explicitly. It asks to calculate the heat. So, you know, that term right there, I almost always start thermodynamic problems with what I think of as the combined first, second law. So I've used this in kind of more general fundamental lectures, and we'll see how it applies today. So we're gonna calculate this heat, and for a specific process. So required to raise the temperature of 1.5 moles of an ideal gas from 15 to 50 degrees Celsius when the volume is fixed at 1 liter. So, and then what is the change in internal energy used to specify the heat to using a specific heat value of heat capacity at constant volume of 25 joule per kmol. Okay, so like I said, I almost always, and it's even asking at some point for the internal energy, but even if it was just asking for the heat component, it would still start here. So why? Because this is really a fundamental starting point for any problem. And, you know, as we said, we can break up the internal energy into heat and work. And this one, you'll quickly recognize, it says that volume is fixed. So that means that term is gone. It's implying, and you can assume that, it's more or less stating explicitly that you also have a fixed volume. So you're not changing the number of moles. You have the number of moles of an ideal gas. It's not reacting. It's not doing anything like that. So that means the number of moles is fixed too. So really, the change in internal energy is just, you know, the change in heat, which I'll you'll see it written in several terms we've talked about earlier. Sometimes it's a delta. I tend to use a derivative with a bar indicating that it's a path-dependent changing quantity, right? So in a sense, you know, the internal energy, if we figure out what the heat is, then we have the internal energy as well. So how does this go? Well, it's shown right here. So, you know, how you change this. So, you'll get a, you know, delta U will be, you know, the change in this heat quantity, right? The change in this heat quantity. And it's written it as, you know, CV delta T, or, you know, implying that this is basically how the heat capacity at constant volume goes dT, right? But how, you know, do we really determine this? So this is covered in both derivations in the book and explicitly in my lecture notes. And so the nice thing about state functions or exact differentials is that for each one of these, we can choose, you know, which variable we want to expand it in. And we can expand this in a partial series, right, where we hold the other ones constant. And this is covered in several screencasts as well. So what we were looking for is, you know, how the heat, which is the same as the internal energy, is changing as a function of temperature, because that's the variable we're changing here. So we want to look at it not as a function of entropy, but as a function of temperature. So let's expand the internal energy in terms of volume, number of moles, which we know are constant, but temperature instead of entropy. And we can do that by writing, by expanding it as a set of partial derivatives, right? And in this case, the partial, how the internal energy changes with temperature at constant volume and number of moles is defined as the molar heat capacity at constant volume. That's how we define it to be. So now you can see directly how this falls out, right? That this dU basically falls out of being this, you know, heat capacity right here, right? And we're holding volume and number of moles fixed in this. So that's how we're able to get to this equation and use it to solve it. We have the number of moles. It's telling you that, you know, a specific thing for the heat capacity, and you know that the change in the temperature is 35 degrees Celsius, which is also 35 degrees Kelvin. And you should always put things in Kelvin for when you're not taking differences, but you're doing division or something else. Always put things in Kelvin. The last thing I want to say here is just something practical about the problem, which is anytime I look at a problem like this, it's not just about getting the answer. It's about also just understanding a few things. Ask yourself, does this seem like it would be an ideal gas? You have 1.5 moles of a gas in 1 liter. Does that seem realistic for an ideal gas? What is the standard temperature and pressure? What is the volume that a standard ideal gas takes up at standard temperature and pressure? This is within, you know, 25 degrees Celsius. It falls within kind of the standard temperature range, right? You know, 1 mole of a gas at standard temperature and pressure, you know, takes up 22 liters. Right? You're confining it down to 1. So this idea that it's going to act ideally is actually, you know, maybe a bit naive in this. The other thing is to get a sense for the heat capacity itself. And this is very important in biological thermodynamics. Does, you know, is 25 joules per kmol, is that reasonable for an ideal gas to have? Well, a monatomic ideal gas has a very defined heat capacity at constant volume. It's 3/2 R. R is 8.3 joule per k mole, 3/2. So it's going to be, you know, what, about 12? You know, about 12 joule per k mole instead of 25. So a monatomic gas actually has significantly lower heat capacity at constant volume. But you will see that as you make an ideal gas from a monatomic to a diatomic, triatomic, et cetera, and add more degrees of freedom, you get heat capacities. And so it's not that unrealistic for something to have a heat capacity of 25 joules per kmol. In fact, molecules like CO2 and triatomic and other larger molecules, water, vapor, et cetera, can easily have this type of heat capacity. So that seems somewhat reasonable. If they didn't give you a heat capacity and just told you it was an ideal gas, it's often very common to assume that an ideal gas is a monatomic, you know, like an inert gas like helium or argon, and to use something like 3/2 R if they didn't give you a value to use to calculate this. So hopefully this gives you a little more further insight into this problem and directly helps you relate some of the mathematics that we use, the partial derivatives in thermodynamics, and how that can play a role, and you can use that in really setting up this problem and gaining more physical intuition. Thanks.